25 years documenting extreme forces of nature and natural phenomenon worldwide, including tornadoes, hurricanes, volcanoes, avalanches, and the effects of climate change. He's best known for having hosted the Canadian TV program Angry Planet. He also co-hosts Storm Hunters on the Weather Channel. He appears in programs for Discovery, Smithsonian Channel, Netflix, and has been frequently invited to comment about global weather and natural disasters by CNN, BBC, CBC, and other news outlets. George earned the Guinness World Record for being the first person to ever set foot at the bottom of the Darvaza Dordahel flaming gas crater in Turkmenistan. The project was funded by the National Geographic Science Grant and was also filmed for the National Geo Television. He holds the title of Explorer in Residence with the Royal Canadian Geographic Society. George has also been the chair of the Canadian chapter of the Explorers Club. The Explorers Club was founded in 1904 to fund polar research. Members of the Explorers Club have included Robert Perry, Ernest Shackleton, Charles Lindbergh, Chuck Yeager, Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong, John Glenn, Thor Heyerdahl, and more recently, Colin O'Brady, the guy who skied solo across Antarctica. So a very august group of people. George frequently is asked to speak at events, including 5 TED Talks, the Global Exploration Summit in Lisbon, Portugal, and the United Nations Environmental Emergency Forum in Oslo, Norway. So please welcome George Kourounis.
Well, thank you very much, Paul. If I'm not mistaken, you're a member of the club too, are you not?
Yes, I am.
Well, that was a name that you left off of that illustrious list, and I wanted to make sure that did not go unmentioned.
All right.
Well, again, thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in this afternoon. And after that amazing introduction, I don't need to do anything else. So what I've got for you today is I've put together a compilation of the wildest and craziest and most extreme and most dramatic expeditions from the past 25 years or so, where I have been literally traveling the world and documenting Mother Nature's temper tantrums. So storms and volcanoes, and I will talk about that Guinness World Record expedition to the fire pit in Turkmenistan. That will be the cherry on top towards the end. So without any further ado, let's dig right into this, because I got a lot of stuff I want to cover. And as was mentioned by Paul, please, if you have any questions, just toss them into the old chat, and we'll be sure to get to as many of those as we can. Get my share screen going here, and we will rock and roll. Here we go. There, that should be full screen now. So yeah, my official title is Explorer in Residence with the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. And I think that's a pretty cool title. And on my business card, it says Explorer, Adventurer, and Storm Chaser. And that's what I do. I basically make my living making television shows about the extremes of nature and also giving presentations to schools and libraries and corporations and things like that. So what I want to do is right off the bat is I'm going to play a video that goes into basically what it's like for me when I go to work. We all have our occupational hazards, and this is what I call another day at the office. And there we go. And I'll do some commentary over top of this as we go. So from some of the most powerful hurricanes, from Hurricane Sandy, Hurricane Katrina, places like Florida, the Gulf Coast, Bermuda, Texas, Jamaica, to over 20 years of tornado chasing across the Great Plains, places like Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska, from the flooded streets of India to the flatlands of the Texas Panhandle. But not just weather, anything extreme involving the natural world. So climbing frozen waterfalls in the Rocky Mountains, to skiing on sand dunes in Timbuktu, to taking an inflatable boat out onto the world's largest lake of sulfuric acid. This is in Indonesia. From Australia to India, New Zealand, Iceland, the Canadian Arctic, the radioactive zone in Chernobyl, to places like the Aral Sea in Uzbekistan. This used to be a fishing village, but the water has all evaporated and now it's a desert. From caves to storms and pretty much every phenomenon in between, including one of my favorites, and that is going to erupting volcanoes all over the world in places like Java, Indonesia, to Italy, to the South Pacific, Hawaii, Cape Verde Islands, Vanuatu, but also wildlife, so diving with sharks, including great whites, Komodo dragon trying to eat me for lunch, swimming with piranhas in Venezuela, and I've even done a little bit of space flight training, but I haven't been to space yet. And one of my favorite places on Earth, which I will talk more about later, the Nazca Crystal Cave in Mexico. Now, my dog sledding skills need a bit of work because I'm not very good at it. And watch for the cobra attacking my camera. That's all real, and that's basically what it's like when I go to work. So it gives you a bit of an idea of some of the hazards that I face and some of the challenges that I undertake. And for me, I'm an explorer. I like to document extreme things, these moments in time where a tornado is touching down or a hurricane is making landfall. There's no new continents to discover, right? All of that has been found years and years ago, and we're only just scraping at space, right? We're going back to the moon, eventually to Mars, and eventually after that, but we're still going to be in our local neighborhood in terms of space. And for me, it's really all been about being curious. I've always been curious, even when I was a kid, very curious kid. And as I grew up, I developed an interest in photography and travel and adventure and exploration. I was working in recording studios for a living, and then I would chase storms in my spare time. I live in Toronto, Canada, and Toronto is home to the CN Tower. It's one of the tallest buildings in the world, and it's an excellent lightning rod. So it gets struck by lightning between 70 to 100 times per year. So when I first started getting interested in this, I didn't have to travel very far to document at least one form of nature's fury. And each one of these lightning bolts can be 100 million volts and 30,000 amps of power, all concentrated into a bolt that's less than the width of your finger. So that is tremendously powerful. And so I love documenting that. And that's sort of how I dipped my toe into this. I would ride my bike down to the waterfront in these storms and photograph the skyline here in Toronto. But then I started pursuing other phenomena and chasing tornadoes and hurricanes, and eventually pretty much any time Mother Nature's having a temper tantrum, I'm almost always nearby with the camera rolling. And I've been super fortunate in that it has allowed me to travel all over the world. I'm up to almost 80 countries now, all seven continents, several times each. I was supposed to be going to Antarctica in November. There's a total solar eclipse at the very beginning of December, December 4th. And I was supposed to be on a ship in the path of that total solar eclipse, and the trip just got canceled this morning. So if you see a little tear running down my cheek, it's because I'm missing out on this once in a lifetime opportunity, but I've still got a few tricks up my sleeve. I may be able to find my way down there for that. As was mentioned, I do a lot of television work. So you may have spotted me on one of these or other TV programs on various networks over the years. Currently, right now, I do a lot of guest shots and appearances on a show called What on Earth, which is on the Science Channel. So watch for me on the Science Channel. But what really kicked things into high gear for me was chasing tornadoes. And I did that for the very first time in 1998. I was able to team up with some other storm chasers that I had met and rode with them and learned the ropes, how to forecast the weather. I'm not a meteorologist, but I know how to forecast the weather by looking at complicated computer models. It's a skill that I've learned over the years. And how to navigate around these storms and try and find the most likely spot for a tornado to occur. And most of that is done in the Tornado Alley area of the United States, northern Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska, eastern Colorado, that kind of spot. I know a lot of you are in California. I'm not sure if all of you are in California, but I know a good portion of you are in California. And of course, you don't get a whole lot of tornado activity in California, although the LA Basin gets one or two per year. So it's not unheard of. But the United States has between 800 to 1200 tornadoes per year. And most of them are in the central part of the states. And about 75% of the entire world's tornadoes happen in the United States, just not in California. Sometimes they're very photogenic and slender. Sometimes they are just absolute massive beasts. And the largest tornado I ever encountered was in late May of 2013 in a town of El Reno, Oklahoma. And this was the largest tornado ever documented. It was 2.6 miles wide. Like, it was so big that it barely even registered in my mind as a tornado. It was just so massive. And it did a fair amount of damage, unfortunately. These are the strongest winds on planet Earth. And the storms that produce these tornadoes can often be twice the height of Mount Everest. And all of that energy is just being concentrated on this one spot that's grinding up a farmer's field, and hopefully not a town. We always stop and help if we encounter people that need assistance. If a car or a house or a town has been hit, we are first aid trained. We stop and we help where we can. We call off the chase, and we get to helping people. Our being there to document it and photograph it and film it does not affect whether the tornado happens or not. But if we come across people needing help, that becomes our number one priority, because that's the right thing to do. So I've also worked, I work a lot with the Weather Network from here in Canada, and we sometimes chase tornadoes for that. But sometimes I work with a gentleman by the name of Tom Dolan and his brother Donald. And there's some researchers from out in California that some of you know. And Tom's got a project called the Tornado Visualization and Doppler Radar Analysis Project. And basically, he and I have teamed up and we've done some storm chasing together. And what we do is we look at these really high-resolution, three-dimensional radar scans that you can see in this illustration. And we compare that with what we visually see on the ground. And that helps us to determine whether or not what the radar is seeing really corresponds with what is actually going on. Because a radar beam, these weather radars, they shoot out a beam that bounces off of raindrops and hailstones and things like that that are in the storm. And that gets reflected back to the radar and it records that. But the radar beam, because of the curvature of the Earth and a few other reasons, it has to go up at a slight angle. So it's impossible for radar to determine exactly what's going on right at the surface. And of course, that's where the tornado is, and that's where the tornado is doing all of its damage. So by correlating these different radar images with visual observations, that can help sort of close the gap in the data. And so that's what Tom works on, and I've been greatly privileged to be able to help out. There we are in Texas. That's Donald on the left, myself in the middle, and Tom on the right. And we are carrying with us one of the historical flags of the Explorers Club. And one thing that is part and parcel with the Explorers Club is they have a collection of these historic flags that can be sent out on loan to various expeditions. So for example, there's one flag that has been to the top of Mount Everest, and it's also been to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. And there's a couple of hundred of these flags, and you can, as a member of the club, you can petition to take one on your expedition, and then you bring it with you and then return it back. And then you submit a report of your expedition to the Explorers Club, and it becomes part of the historical archive of scientific discovery at headquarters for the Explorers Club in New York. So it's a real privilege to be able to carry one of these flags. And I've been lucky enough to carry this, not this particular flag, but many Explorers Club flags on various expeditions, about five or six of them over the years. So that's a lot of fun. And that whole trip was all about trying to, again, fill in that gap between what the radar sees and what we can see on the ground. And some of these storms, they really remind me of, what's that movie? Independence Day. These gigantic Martian spaceships, basically, you know, just plowing through the atmosphere. They really take on that mothership appearance. And it's in these lowered areas that you see just over the windmill farm here. That's typically where a tornado is going to form and touch down. So these are the areas that we're trying to navigate around and trying to see. Of course, these storms do not obey the speed limits. They don't stop for traffic lights. They don't care about speed traps. So it can be very difficult to follow these storms. And quite often the road network does not cooperate. So it can be extremely difficult. One other thing that I did for 12 seasons, and when I say seasons, tornado season is typically in May and June. That's when we get the bulk of our tornadoes in North America. For 12 seasons, I worked as a tornado chasing tour guide with a company called Cloud Nine Tours. So people would fly to Oklahoma City, we would pick them up at the airport, and we would take them in a convoy of two or three vehicles, and we would spend 2 weeks living like nomads, driving across the Great Plains, following the weather forecasts, trying to witness and document these tornadoes. And so I've got a video clip here from one of those particular trips. This one's from South Dakota. And I'll just let this rip here and I'll talk over top of it. So I've got a group of people with us, and this tornado touches down, very large one, out in a field.
Hey, Charles.
I got a crazy idea.
That close?
What?
That close?
Yeah.
So I'm convincing my navigator to get back in the van and drive to where we think the tornado is going to cross the road.
Long live.
And when we pull over here, you'll be able to see the tornado is moving from left to right. There it is. So it's not coming towards us. So we're where we are, but it's going to pass just behind this little church. But the wind is so intense that as soon as I open the door, take some photos, all of my maps get sucked out of the van. Now, have you ever been on the highway and the driver beside you is completely oblivious, not paying attention to what's going on? Watch the oncoming headlights here. How does this person not notice that there's a tornado barreling straight towards them? Like, they just miss it. I tell you, if that had been me, I probably would have needed a new pair of underwear then. So from weather phenomena to geologic phenomena, my favorite is, of course, the most dazzling and the most spectacular are volcanic eruptions. And I don't know if you've been watching the news, but just yesterday, a brand new volcanic eruption, the first time in 50 years, the island of La Palma in the Canary Islands just started erupting with these very spectacular fountains of lava shooting hundreds of yards up into the air. So I really should be on an airplane right now heading towards the Canary Islands, but COVID makes that a little difficult right now to drop everything and just go with what with COVID testing and all kinds of other nonsense that's made travel so complicated for the past 2 years, let me tell you. Oh, it's been so frustrating. This particular volcano that you see here, that's Anak Krakatau. You might know it better as Krakatoa. Of course, Krakatoa had this gigantic eruption back in 1883, and it was the loudest sound ever heard. There were people 2,000 kilometers away. Sorry, I was going to switch back and forth between metric and imperial sometimes because I'm Canadian and I don't always know the conversion. But there were people 2,000 kilometers away in Australia that heard the sound of that volcano exploding. And it has slowly been rebuilding itself with smaller eruptions. And so the island that used to be quite large is now small, but slowly rebuilding itself. So who knows, we may have another gigantic eruption from Krakatoa at some point in the future. It has had some pretty big ones in the past few years. Getting up close to volcanoes that explode is extremely tricky and very dangerous. I prefer volcanoes that have more effusive properties. They tend to have lava flows or lakes of lava. That's what I really love, are these lakes of lava. And yes, that is me. This is at the bottom of Maroom Crater on Ambrim Island in Vanuatu. And if you go to a map, you can find Vanuatu between Fiji and Australia in the South Pacific. And it's an archipelago of about 80 islands, and several of them are very active volcanically. And this one is extremely active. And to give you an idea, to get to that point, you have to rappel on ropes from the top of the crater down inside the pit. And it's 1,200 feet. So you could take the entire Empire State Building and fit it inside that crater. So it's absolutely massive. And at the bottom is this 60-yard wide lake of boiling lava. And I'm wearing a special heat protective suit that's made out of an aluminum coated material, kind of like what you would wear if you worked in a steel mill. And that helps to protect me from getting third degree burns from the radiant heat. So I'm going to show you a video of what it looks like to stand at this point here. And bear in mind, there's no Photoshop, there's no CGI, no green screen, it's all real. A lot of people on YouTube claim that this video is fake, and I assure you that it is not.
The bottom of Maroom Volcano is one of the most spectacular places in the world. At the same time, it's also one of the most dangerous and difficult to get to.
So this liquid rock just literally boils away 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it sounds like just waves of water hitting a rocky shoreline, except it's between 1500 and 2000 degrees hot. And here you'll get the chance to see an idea of the size and scale. You'll see me at the bottom, the small silver figure at the bottom. Well, it's pretty big. I currently own 3 of these protective heat suits. And the very first one I ever bought, I got it used on eBay for $100. I cannot recommend buying used safety equipment on eBay. That one has long since been retired, and I have a tailor now, a special company that makes industrial clothing in Niagara Falls, and they custom tailor them for me. So that was definitely a big improvement in quality and safety. In the early days, I didn't have a lot of funds to work with. But you do what you got to do. You improvise. Whoops. There we go. And shooting some of that video, that's what happened to my camera. It actually started to melt. So it was so hot, I had to hide behind some rocks, put my camera in record, and then place the camera on top of the rocks while I hid from the heat. And I just counted to 10 while it was recording. And then I'd take my camera off and the hood, the plastic hood, was just starting to sag and melt from the intense heat. So that gives you an idea of what it's like in there. And what I find really fascinating is that if you were to shrink planet Earth down to the size of an apple, that cool crust that we live on is about as thick as the skin on that apple. And underneath, just under our feet, we have this unbelievable heat that just, you know, makes its way to the surface every now and then in these blisters that we call volcanoes, which is really fascinating. And there you can see this is some of those splashes of lava are much higher than my head. And I'm gathering a fresh rock sample there. So that's a fresh bit of lava that has just landed. It's still warm. I can feel the warmth through my special aluminum gloves. And it's pretty intense to say the least. That's for sure. And over the years, I've done about 5 expeditions to this island. We have to helicopter in, set up a base camp at the summit, and we'll live there for, I think my record is, usually it's between a week to 5 weeks up there, waiting for a good clear day. The volcano creates its own weather, so it's hard to get a good clear weather day to get down there because you don't want to be in there when it's raining. It's just very unpleasant. The rain turns to acid rain and it dissolves everything that's metal. It's very harsh. But over the years, I've done 11 descents down to that bottom of that crater. And we've brought TV crews down there. We brought an IMAX film team down there one time. We brought scientists. We even brought a Saudi princess down there one time. So it's been a real adventure going back to this particular volcano. And that lake of lava actually drained about 2 years ago. It no longer exists. Hopefully it'll come back. And while I was down there, I took a selfie. I've got my gas mask on because of the sulfur gas and my heat suit. And I posted this to Twitter and it went totally viral. It was on CNN. It was on all these lists of top 10 most extreme selfies. It just had legs and had a life of its own. That one particular photo that I just haphazardly decided, oh, I'm down here, I might as well shoot a selfie. But there's a couple more places I want to talk to you about because I'm sure many of you have questions. And both of these require a bit of explanation because they're so bizarre and so cool. So in that opening video, you saw a couple of quick shots of this place, the Nika Crystal Cave in Mexico. And if you've ever been to a rock and gem store, you've probably seen these purple amethyst geodes. Sometimes they come in different types of minerals, but they're always these sort of these hollow rocks that are filled with crystals. Well, imagine the world's largest geode, one that's the size of a basketball court. And that's what we have here. It was accidentally discovered by miners. It's actually in a mine, a silver and lead mine in Mexico, 900 feet underground. And back in the year 2000, they were mining away and chipping away at the walls of one of these mine shafts, and they broke through into this chamber that contained something that no one had ever seen before. These crystals are the size of tree trunks. They're just absolutely massive. Some of them are 30 feet long and weigh 55 tons. They are by far the biggest crystals in the world. And what makes this place even more fascinating than just the visual aspect of these humongous crystals, is the fact that it's so hot and humid in here that as soon as you enter the cave, you slowly start to die. And you will eventually die because the air temperature is somewhere in the neighborhood of 122 degrees Fahrenheit or slightly warmer. So you've got the heat of the Sahara Desert. But it's also incredibly humid, almost 100% humidity. So you've also got the humidity of the Amazon jungle combined together. So that heat and humidity makes it absolutely deadly. The air is warmer than your skin. So you can't radiate heat away from your body, but you sweat like crazy. But the sweat doesn't evaporate because it's so humid. So you just build up this heat in your body and eventually you're gonna pass out from a heat stroke and you will die. Partially because if you've ever had a cold beer on a hot, humid day, and I know you have, I mean, who hasn't? You know that condensation that forms on the outside of the beer bottle, right? That's because the beer is cold and it cools the air that's in contact with that beer bottle. And the humidity in the air cools to a point where it condenses and forms water droplets. And that's why you get this sweaty beer bottle. Well, in a cave like this, the coolest thing is you, including the inside of your lungs. So when you breathe in that hot, humid air, it actually cools because your body is cooler than the air itself. and you can get condensation that forms in your lungs. So you can drown from breathing the air inside this cave. So we had to wear a lot of special equipment just to go in here. And it took me the better part of 2 years to get permission to go to this cave just for one day. It's owned by the mining company. It's very difficult and expensive, and there's a lot of red tape trying to get permission to go here. It's not open to the public. It's because it's so dangerous. But we got permission to go there. I was filming for my TV show, Angry Planet. And the clothing that we're wearing is very specialized. So I've got a vest on, and the vest is protecting me from frostbite. Now, I know you think that's crazy. It's so hot. Why would you be worried about frostbite? Well, because the next layer that you're wearing is a vest full of ice. And that helps to keep your body core temperature down. And you need to protect yourself from that so you don't get frostbite on your chest. And then another layer of orange coveralls goes over top of that. And that helps to protect you from getting cut on the crystals and helps to keep that cool layer against, inside those coveralls. And then on my back, we've got this big bulky backpack that's filled with ice canisters and a fan that blows air over the ice canisters through a hose and then to a mask that's very similar to the kind that a fighter pilot would wear. So that allows you to breathe chilled air. And with all this equipment, it's very bulky, very difficult. We could go inside the cave for about 45 minutes at a time. And then the ice is all melted and you have to leave. You're starting to overheat. And when you leave the cave, there's a big steel door that they've put in to separate the cave from the rest of the mine. So you exit the steel door and then you go to the cool area, which is a really nice, refreshing 110 degrees. It really is very nice. It's the most refreshing 110 degrees that you'll ever experience by comparison to what it's like inside the cave. And we would drink like a gallon of Mexican tap water and then wait for about 45 minutes or so or an hour to sort of cool off and recharge. And then we'd be able to go back in for another 45 minutes or so. And we only had permission to do this for one day. There are spots in this cave where very few people have ever stood. The crystals themselves are made out of selenite, which is crystallized gypsum. And that is the same material that your drywall, gyprock, it's gypsum. It's the same stuff. So what's in your walls, this very common mineral, under the right conditions, with tremendous amounts of time and dissolved in hot water for 500 to 600,000 years, it will crystallize into these gigantic crystals. And being here, I tell you, it's so visually stunning that you don't want to leave. It's just so beautiful. But at the same time, every cell in your body is screaming at you to leave because the heat and humidity is so incredibly oppressive. When you walk in, it feels like a sledgehammer hitting you in the face. But it is so bizarre. It's very much like being on an alien planet. There was a movie called The Core, a really bad science fiction movie, like really bad, where they tunnel down to the center of the Earth and they break into a chamber that is filled with gigantic crystals. And I'm pretty sure it was modeled after the Nika Crystal Cave. Now, the cave has since flooded. They use gigantic pumps to pump water out of the silver mine because a lot of the mine is below the water table. And there was an accident. There was a flash flood that damaged some of the pumps. And at last I heard, the cave was underwater again. So who knows when or if human eyes will ever be able to take another look at this marvel of nature. And yes, I was able to bring one of the Explorers Club flags down there with me. It really was a tremendous privilege to be able to go to this place. There's one of the one of our helpers. Those are the chilled ice packs. He's putting it in an industrial freezer, and this is what chills the air that we breathe through the backpack respirator system. And there's the mask. So that's sort of what it looks like. And all of our cameras had to be preheated. So we would put our cameras in a plastic bag and put them in the cave and let them warm up to the ambient temperature of the cave. Because if we didn't do that, the cold camera would have caused all this condensation, and it would have fogged the lens, and it would have shorted out the electronics inside. And even with all of those precautions, we still destroyed one of our big cameras in the cave that day. So yeah, super difficult, really hard to do anything in there. But it is spectacular. I would give anything for the opportunity to go back there, but I think I might need a special heat-proof submarine to get there now. And I don't know if that technology exists, but that would be pretty cool though. One more big expedition that I want to cover with you guys, and it was already, Paul already mentioned it in the intro. I did a big project for National Geographic, and it's in the country of Turkmenistan. And for those of you, I'm assuming that no one on this call has been to the country of Turkmenistan. More people go to North Korea every year. As a matter of fact, North Korea gets 3 times the number of tourists every year compared to Turkmenistan. It's one of the former Soviet republics. It's just north of Iran and Afghanistan. And it's known for having a lot of crazy dictators over the years. As a matter of fact, not the guy who's in power now, but the guy before him, he changed the name of the days of the week to his family members' names in his favorite book. He changed the name of the months. He outlawed beards. He made all these crazy laws. So it's very much a stricter dictatorship, a lot like North Korea. And so why would I want to go there? Well, it just so happens that something happened in Turkmenistan. They were drilling for natural gas in the desert, and the drilling rig collapsed and formed a sinkhole. And that sinkhole is about 100 feet deep and 230 feet wide. And it's leaking methane gas. Methane gas is the main component of natural gas. And at some point, that leaking methane gas got lit on fire. And it's been burning ever since. That was 50 years ago. And the locals call it the doorway to hell. Darvaza means doorway. And you can totally understand why they call it the doorway to hell. This pit of burning gas literally has been, you know, flaming away for decades. And so I didn't want to just go here to see it. That's too easy. So the idea that I pitched to National Geographic was this. I told them that NASA has discovered planets outside of our solar system that have hot methane-rich environments. If I could go to this crater and gather samples from the bottom, if I could find any kind of microscopic bacteria living in the soil at the bottom of this hot methane-rich crater, it could give us clues as to where we might want to look for life on other planets. So the pitch basically boiled down to looking for alien life here on Earth. They loved the idea. They gave me a science grant to do it, but no one had ever done this before. So I had to figure out how to do this in a country that is as restrictive and oppressive as North Korea. So that took about a year and a half to figure all of that out. We were spied on by the government. There were all kinds of complications. The equipment that I needed had to be specially designed and built because no one had ever done this before. And I put together a team of rope riggers and a microbiologist from Chicago and some logistics experts and a big TV crew from National Geographic. And in the fall of 2013, we made it to Turkmenistan. And this was what it looked like. You're out there in the middle of the desert. There's nothing around for miles and miles except this perfectly circular hole that looks like a volcano, but it's a burning pit of fire. And my objective was to go to the bottom and gather some soil samples and see what's living down there, if anything at all. And let me tell you, it was the best fire pit. We had the best campsite. I forgot to bring a long stick and some marshmallows. That's the one thing I regret about that expedition, is not bringing that stuff along with me. So there's two ways that you could do this. You could take a robot and drop it down on some steel cables or something, let the robot roll around the bottom and then use it to gather some samples and then pull the robot up. But where's the fun in that? Where's the spirit of adventure? So what we did is we spent a week camped out, studying the crater. We measured how the airflow is circulating around the crater, where the hot parts are, where the cool parts are. And we determined that the fire is heating the air, which rises up along the edges, and then cooler air drops down in the center of the pit to be heated by the fire. So it's like a big donut or a convection oven. So the best place to drop down would be right in the dead center. So what we did was we spotted this one. If you notice in the very middle of the crater at the bottom, there's a gigantic flame. And then just to the right, there's a spot where there's no fire at all. So that was our target. That was going to be the spot where I was going to drop down and begin my sample gathering. So that was the plan. And of course, you're in the middle of the desert. And if you forget any one single piece of gear, there's no Walmart nearby. There's Amazon does not deliver here. So you have to be completely self-sufficient. And the plan was to stretch fire-resistant ropes across the entire crater. And then I would clip onto these ropes and roll out to the middle on pulleys with my heat suit and self-contained breathing apparatus, and then drop down to the very bottom, gather my soil samples. So there I am on the left. I've got my air, which is very hard to get air tanks filled in Turkmenistan. That was a big challenge. The harness is made of Kevlar, which is the same stuff they make bulletproof vests out of, because a regular climbing harness would have melted from the heat. Got my heat protective suit. There's the TV crew from National Geographic. They're getting ready to film me as I step off and put all my weight onto the ropes. And let me tell you, at this moment here, as I'm about to step off, it is absolutely terrifying. The rope that I'm using is only 7 millimeters thick. And it's not very reassuring to use such a thin little rope, but it's very strong and certainly could do the job. But looking at it, it's very intimidating. Certainly the most intimidating thing I've ever done. And once I was on the rope, you feel like a piece of laundry out on the line. And I was able to go out to the middle and then drop down. I had control of my own descent, but the team had the ability to pull me up and out should anything go wrong, even if I were to fall unconscious. And so I made it to the bottom. If you look really closely, kind of like a Where's Waldo poster, look just right of the biggest flame and you'll see a little humanoid figure there. Let me zoom in here. There we go. And now I'll zoom back out. It gives you a bit of perspective of how big that flame is. And so as I would move around, I would gather samples in a few different spots. And I had an earpiece in. And the microbiologist who was going to be analyzing these samples was giving me instructions as to where I should go. And so I would gather these samples and then give them to him. And he would take them back to Chicago to do a DNA analysis to see if there's any bacteria living in these soils. Now, interestingly, National Geographic gave me the money to go and do this as a science grant. But the TV crew, I didn't have a lot of control over the TV crew. And National Geographic decided they wanted to use this as one episode of a larger series that they called Die Trying, which I didn't really appreciate because I was the guy who was trying. I would have preferred if they'd call it Or Die Trying. I think that would have been more appropriate, but you know, they vetoed all of my objections on that. And let me tell you, it was the best feeling in the world being lifted up and out of that crater. It was almost 2 years of planning and preparation. We spent about 2 weeks in Turkmenistan, and all of that was for 17 minutes at the bottom. That was it. That's all I had, 17 minutes. And I've got a little clip here. I've got a video clip from Die Trying that shows you what it was like to be at the bottom. Oh, no, I don't. Oh, sorry, I don't have the video clip here. That's unfortunate. Yeah, that's okay. That's not the end of the world. But definitely being at the bottom there and looking around, I kind of describe it as a coliseum of fire. You can go onto YouTube and you can search for this place, and you'll see lots of videos of it. It really is tremendously spectacular. And Guinness recognized the feat with a Guinness World Record for being the first person to ever set foot at the bottom of this crater. And yes, we did find bacteria living at the bottom of that crater. There were several different types of bacteria living in the fire pit that were not found in the surrounding soil along the surface. So we don't know how it got there. It actually raises more questions than answers. And hopefully, maybe in a few generations from now, when we're sending people out outside of our solar system, hopefully the data that we gathered might help direct them to be able to discover at least some kind of microbial life living on another planet. And if we do, it will completely change all of the biology textbooks and everything we know about life. So it won't happen in my lifetime, but it's nice to know that perhaps I was able to contribute a small amount to what could amount to being one of the greatest scientific discoveries in human history that I won't get to see. I'll never know. So that's pretty crazy. So I know I'm not sure what our time is like. That's probably the end of my time. I believe it is, but I want to make sure that we at least have the opportunity to answer some questions, because I can see there's some questions in the chat. So let's hit some of those.
Yeah. So Sam, how are we doing on time? How much time do we have? Or Neil, how much time do we have, do you think?
Yeah, I think we can go ahead and answer the questions.
Great.
Yeah. I'm not in a rush. I'm happy to answer whatever we have time for.
Yeah. Sam asked, can you comment on your observations for climate change during your travels?
Yeah. It's hard for me to remain positive, having seen everything that I have seen, particularly in the Arctic. There are parts of the Arctic where we're seeing warming that is double or sometimes four times higher than the global average. And as a Canadian, that really frightens me. I've had the opportunity to visit with people in Bangladesh who have lost their homes due to sea level rise. Not just lost their homes, lost their property. They would point out to the sea and say, that's where my farm used to be. And that's disheartening. And we're seeing changes in sea surface temperatures, which provides more fuel for hurricanes. So we're expected to have stronger hurricanes. You know, there's two things we really need to do. We need to reduce our carbon emissions, and we need to come up with better ways to sequester the carbon that's already in the atmosphere. And there's some pretty easy ways to do that with more sustainable farming methods and things like that, which are not that hard to do. So we just need more people on board with some of these techniques. It's not impossible. I still have hope, but it's getting harder and harder for me to stay as hopeful, having seen what I've seen.
One of the questions is, what is the riskiest, dangerous trek you've experienced?
Riskiest, dangerous. Wow. So certainly the fire pit in Turkmenistan, because no one had ever done it before, so I had no point of reference. There have been times where I've been inside a volcanic crater where pieces of lava have been flying overhead and landing behind me. Being in the middle of Hurricane Katrina as it came ashore and ripping apart all of the Gulf Coast was absolutely terrifying. I got bitten by a bat in a cave in Kenya one time, and this cave is known for having outbreaks of Marburg hemorrhagic fever, which is part of the Ebola family. So if you catch it, your internal organs liquefy and you bleed them out of every orifice. So I spent a week not knowing if that was how I was going to die. And we know that the virus is transmitted by bats. So that was completely terrifying.
Right. How long does it take you to prepare for a tornado chase?
Tornado chases, because it's seasonal, I know exactly the period of time when that happens. Usually the last 2 weeks of May is the prime time. I'm good to go. I have all my equipment in my basement organized in tubs and all labeled and everything. So I can be ready to go anywhere in the world for any reason in about an hour. So I try to be able to do that, because sometimes that happens. Something will come up and I'll jump on a plane and go. Sometimes it's 2 years of planning. So it really does depend, but I have to be able to go if the situation requires.
Yeah. How do you navigate? I mean, I was always under the impression that tornadoes, you know, are somewhat arbitrary or erratic. How do you navigate? How do you stay out of its way?
25 years of observing them.
Okay.
In North America, typically tornadoes move from southwest to northeast, but not always. So that's the general idea. Now, in the vehicles, we have pretty sophisticated setups where we have real-time NEXRAD radar displayed from the National Weather Service. So the tornadoes will typically follow along with the storm that has created them. So if we can see the storm on radar and what direction it's moving, we have a pretty good idea which direction and speed the tornado is moving as well. And we can see, using the radar, we can see the rotation in these storms. So we know exactly which part of the storm is likely to have a tornado. The big problem is that there's a delay, usually about 5 to 10 minutes between when that scan was taken, gets processed, gets transmitted along the internet, and then gets displayed on our screen.
Right.
So we always have to think a few minutes in the future.
Very good.
Excellent. Scary. Yeah, scary.
Absolutely. I've been avoiding tornadoes since I grew up in the Midwest. I'm very impressed with your ability to deal with the fear of going out and doing this. Let's see. Are you finding the frequency and severity of weather increasing in these days?
Yes, absolutely. Particular in terms of floods, droughts, wildfires, and heat waves. Those are the things that we're expecting to see more of those, and we are indeed seeing more of those. And those phenomena can be directly linked to climate change. That has been proven. We know that. Science has, they've put a stamp on that. We know that. What's more difficult is saying that climate change produces more tornadoes. That we don't know. We have some suspicions. It's going to take a lot more years worth of research, but we have some suspicions that Tornado Alley is moving further east due to changes in the jet stream pattern and things like that. So instead of maybe 20 years from now, instead of tornadoes being in places like Kansas and Oklahoma, we may see more of them in places like Ohio and you know, states like that, which have much higher population densities. That's a bit worrisome as well.
Yeah. Someone asked, John Madden asked, what's the cost of the Turkmenistan expedition?
I had some sponsors on that. My grant from Nat Geo was about $60,000 or $65,000 for that expedition. And I came in under budget. So I actually had to give money back to Nat Geo. So that's very rare. So I was able to work it so that I was under budget. About a third of that cost went to just having insurance. And the only company that would insure me for that expedition was Lloyd's of London.
Excellent. Do you have your travel plans for Mars set up yet?
Mars? Oh, well, we'll see. Yeah. I don't have Elon Musk's direct line. So, but I know some people that know him. So maybe I can,
Right.
We'll see. We'll see. That's still a ways off. But if I had the opportunity to go, of course I would take it.
Tom asked, how much of climate change is man-made?
How much of climate change is man-made? I'm not a climatologist, so it's hard for me to say exactly like what percentage and such. So don't quote me on this. David Phillips or someone else would be a much better authority on giving you exact numbers because I don't have those in front of me right now. But let's say, for example, a lot of people think that volcanoes produce a lot of greenhouse gases. And they do. However, compared to what humans put into the atmosphere, it's less than 2%. So that just sort of puts things in perspective.
Right.
So let's just go with a tremendous amount. And we know it's a tremendous amount. I just want to give an exact number because I don't want to misrepresent because I just don't know off the top of my head.
Neil Smith noticed that we have a lot of heat in California with our forest fires.
Yes.
Would you like to come visit any of our forest fires, he was asking?
Yes, I would love to. So I have been embedded with firefighters, wildfire fighters in numerous places, in the Yukon, in Australia. In Australia, it was crazy. We had the busiest or the biggest fire in the Adelaide area in 35 years. And I was embedded with these firefighters and we're driving through these wildfires like you see in these YouTube videos. And we were so close that we were getting water bombed by these bombers dropping retardant all around us. And that's one thing I'm very concerned with in terms of places like, pardon me, California, Oregon, British Columbia, is the intensity and severity of the wildfire seasons, right? I mean, just look how bad it's been every year, and it's getting worse every single year.
Right.
It's awful. I hope none of you who are on here have been directly affected by the fires. I know it's likely maybe you know someone who has, but I hope no one here has.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Let's see. What's your next adventure? We just got that question up.
Well, my next adventure was supposed to be going to the solar eclipse in Antarctica.
Right, yeah.
But that got shot down. I don't know. COVID has put a real monkey wrench into my plans. I've had to cancel everything. Right. I got back. I was filming a TV show about volcanoes in Japan last year. And I got home on March 11th of 2020. And within a couple of days, everything shut down. And I've been basically stuck at home. I've done a little bit of travel here and there. I was in the Azores for the Global Exploration Summit. And I was out in British Columbia recently. But basically, all of my expeditions have been canceled. All of my storm chases, the record-breaking hurricane season that you had in the US last year, I had to miss out on all of it because I wasn't able to travel.
Right.
I do have plans to be in Borneo in January. I have plans to be in Egypt. I've got plans to be in Greenland. We'll see if any of those come to fruition.
Okay. Sounds great. Spectacular stories. Thank you, George. It's been really a fun time. I've really enjoyed this.
Thank you so much. My pleasure. I'm so happy that you allowed me to come and share my stories with you today.
Yeah, thank you. Sam, can we turn it back to you then?
Absolutely. Thanks a lot, George. Really great presentation. And.